listen, first thing off, let's pull out our note sheet you got on the way in, because I really want you to have the scripture in front of you today. We are in a series called I Am. And what we've been doing, we have been talking the past few months about the I Am statements of Christ. Now, this is part 8. So we have had 7 previous messages in this series, and today we're doing one called the Alpha and Omega. Jesus said, I am the Alpha and Omega. Now, let me just confess something to you. Of all 10 of these messages in this series, this has been the most difficult to put together. I'm sure you don't really aren't that interested in knowing that and caring about that. But, you know, I put a lot of time into putting these things together, and this one stumped me for a long time. Not necessarily because I don't know what Alpha and Omega means, but really how to connect it to you. Because, guys, my job is to connect God's Word to your life. And so I thought and thought and thought and thought and thought about how we can do that. So I want to have you pull out one of my favorite things. Do you remember these as a kid? I used to love these things, okay? When I was growing up, I'm not talking about a teenager, but when I was like in first, second grade, I loved connect the dot puzzles. Anybody else like those? All right, I love those. So I thought you would like to have a connect dot puzzle, and you can even work on it right now, okay? So the cool thing about the connect the dot puzzle is that as you connect the dots, you know how these things work, that you're going to connect all the dots. There it is on screen. There's the puzzle that you have in your hand. And you're going to connect the dots. I think there's 55 connecting points. There's 55 lines that you've got to draw to complete the picture. And what's going to happen is, I'm sorry to be spoiler alert here, but, you know, what's going to happen is when you connect the dots, you're going to get that. You're going to connect the dots, get this, and you're going to see Jesus. Isn't that cool? And guys, that is what we do every time we come to Scripture. We connect the dots of the Bible so that we can see Jesus in our lives and in the truth that is defined there. Now, this quote is not in your notes, but I want you to look on screen just for a minute. You keep doing your puzzle. It's okay. I like this statement. Good biblical exegesis. Now, let's just stop there, because that's one of those weird, wacky Christian preacher Bible words, exegesis. I bet you probably haven't said the word exegesis in your whole life this week, have you? Oh, how's your exegesis? Well, I've got a little. No, that's not it, okay? You probably haven't even thought about the word exegesis. Okay? Exegesis is really a compound word in the Greek, and it literally means to lead out of, okay? To lead out of something, and that's kind of its root meaning. And the basic idea, when we talk about biblical exegesis, we are drawing out of the text what it means versus reading into it, which is putting our own spin on the Bible. Some people want to put their own spin on the Bible, right? I mean, do we live in a world where they want to spin the Bible to make it say anything you want to say? In fact, the Bible talks about twisting Scripture. So we're talking about biblical exegesis, where you're drawing out of the Bible what it says, just so you get that clear. So let's go back to the statement. Good biblical exegesis is like connect the dots. Ding, ding, ding. Now you see why you have the drawing. One takes biblical data points, the dots, and draws relationships between them, the lines, the connection, to form a complete picture, right? That's what we're talking about. Look, there it is. Okay, there's the dots. The lines are drawn to connect and to get a complete picture. This process helps people understand Scripture, because why? They see the big picture. Guys, that's what we want to do every time we come to Scripture, is we want to understand it. Now, the statement we're talking about today, remember, we're talking about the big picture. There's the big picture. We see Jesus. The passage we're talking about today is found in Revelation. And in fact, all 3 of these statements, Jesus repeated it 3 different times. I am the Alpha and Omega. 3 different times in the book of Revelation, he used this statement referring to himself. But to understand the implications of what that means, everybody look up here. To understand what that means for you, we're going to have to connect the dots. We're going to have to see what exactly that means so that we're going to get out of this passage everything God wants us to hear. So let's look at the passage itself. Three different times Jesus says in the book of Revelation, read it. The Lord says, I am the Alpha and Omega, the one who was, the one who is, the one who was, and the one who is coming. I am God all-powerful. Then he says, write down what I have said. My words are true and can be trusted. Everything is finished. I am, say it with me, the Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the end. Keep reading. I am coming soon. And when I come, I will reward everyone for what they have done. Look at it a third time. I am, say it, Alpha and Omega, the first and the last, the beginning and the end. Revelation 1, Revelation 21, Revelation 22, Jesus makes this incredible statement about himself. So, what in the heck does it mean, right? What is he talking about? Alpha and Omega. I want you to see something. This is in your notes in the box, and I want you to just read it with me. The first letter in the Greek alphabet is Alpha. Hey, Alphabet. Isn't that cool? We get the word Alpha in the Greek as the first letter of the alphabet, Alpha, and it makes the same sound as our letter A. Omega is the last letter in the Greek alphabet. Okay, we have Z, they have Omega. All of the ancient knowledge is contained within that alphabet. Okay? Just as in our English alphabet, where all knowledge is contained from A to Z. Every concept, everything, every fact really has its roots in the letters A to Z, Alpha to Omega. Keep reading. If you have a dictionary, I'm sure you have one with you this morning, don't you, right? You carry a bit, no. You might have one on your phone. If you have a dictionary or an encyclopedia, think about the fact that all of our knowledge is basically found within these pages, beginning with the letter A all the way to Z, because Jesus is the Alpha and Omega, get this, he is the beginning of all things and the end of all things. He is then everything, right? A to Z and all things in between. He is the consummation of the entire Greek alphabet, meaning this, that he is all and in all and creator of all. That's why he made this incredible statement. I am the Alpha and Omega. I am the A to Z. I am everything there is in me. Pretty powerful statement. Incredibly powerful. Because Jesus, now remember, this is after his life, after his death, after his burial, after his resurrection, after his ascension into heaven. That's when these words were given. These words were given long after Jesus had been on the earth. In fact, John was an old man, the apostle John, and he was exiled to the island of Patmos, and that is where he got this revelation. Okay? And so this is years after the time of Christ, and he returns to John to say, I'm everything, and everything is in me. So what does that mean for us? Well, I'm going to give you three things, three thoughts this morning in the time that I have, and I really want you to get it, okay? First of all, Jesus is the Alpha and Omega for my eternity, okay? Write that down. Jesus is the Alpha and Omega for my eternity. Now, what do we have to do? Revelation 1, Revelation 21, Revelation 22, 23, we have to go back now and we have to connect some dots. Are you with me? Okay? We're going to connect some dots. So we're going to understand what that means when Jesus made that statement. In order to do that, we're first going to go back to the Gospel of John. In the Gospel of John, remember, John is the same guy who wrote the Gospel of John that wrote or received the revelation of Christ, the last book in the Bible. So look what John says in the very beginning of the Gospel of John. Before anything else existed, say those next three words with me. There was Christ. Remember Alpha and Omega, beginning and the end? Before anything else existed, there was Christ with God. He has always been alive. Alpha, Omega. And is himself God. He created everything there is. Alpha and Omega. Nothing exists that he didn't make. Now, we're going from Revelation 1, Revelation 22, Revelation 23, and we're drawing a dot, a line from that dot to John chapter 1. We're connecting the dots. Look at the next one. This is in Colossians. Christ is the exact likeness of the unseen God. Guys, there is absolutely no debate among honest theologians with integrity that Jesus and God are exactly the same. There's no debate about it. There's no question. To make Jesus less than God or other than God is really not even being theologically accurate and honest. Jesus Christ is the exact likeness of the unseen God. Next phrase. He existed before God made anything at all. What is that? Alpha, right? And in fact, Christ himself is the creator who made everything to Omega. You get it? We're connecting the dots. The things we can see, the things we can't see, all were made by Christ for his own use and glory. Keep reading. He was before all else began. What is that? Alpha. And it is his power that holds everything together, Omega. He is the head of the body made up of his people, that is his church, which he began. That's a word of Alpha. He was the Alpha of the church. And he is the first Alpha to come back from life, so that he is the first Alpha in everything, Omega. Do you see it? Are we connecting the dots? Are you getting this? This is amazing. All right? This is what the Bible means when it says Jesus is the Alpha and Omega. How about this one? Hebrews 7:3. Now, just so you kind of get this, the book of Hebrews is a very interesting book, and it uses a lot of what we call typology and a lot of different metaphors and ideas. One of the things in the book of Hebrews is it uses a name, Melchizedek, which you see there, the first letter in the first word in that passage, to be a reference to Christ. Melchizedek is a picture of Jesus. And that would be a whole another long Bible study that we don't have time to go into. But just take my word for it, in the book of Hebrews, Melchizedek is referring to Jesus. Just get that. Okay? So look what it says. Melchizedek was without a father or mother or any family. Okay, that's why it can't be a human being, number one, because all human beings have a mother and a father. You wouldn't be here if you didn't have a mother and a father, okay? I mean, you just can't exist as a human being if you didn't have a mother and father. So we know that that is not talking about somebody that is earthly, okay? Even though Jesus had an earthly mother, it is elevating the idea of who Jesus is. Look at the next part. He had no what? Beginning or end. Okay? In other words, he's always been there. He didn't have a starting point, doesn't have an ending point. He's Alpha and Omega. In fact, it says he is forever like the Son of God. Now, Hebrews is very, very clear that this Jesus that we're talking about, this Alpha and Omega, we're connecting another dot. Remember, we've gone from Revelation 1, Revelation 22, Revelation 23, we connected a dot to John 1, then we connected a dot to Colossians 1, and now we're connecting a dot to Hebrews 7, and we're all seeing what it means that Jesus is my Alpha and Omega for eternity. And then there's one more you have to connect. Because in the same book of Hebrews, one of my very favorite verses that gives me so much assurance, look what it says. Jesus Christ is the same, what? Yesterday, guess what? That's Alpha. Today and forever. That is Omega. Are you with me? Have I lost you yet on this? Jesus is the Alpha and Omega for my eternity. That's why every problem you face, every struggle you're going through, every mountain you've got to climb, every valley you sink into, you can trust and rely on Jesus because he's the Alpha and Omega and he's God and he's got it all together, even when we don't. Boy, you ought to get excited about that on a really rainy Sunday morning, okay? And so three things jump out. Jesus is the Alpha and Omega for eternity, which means that he is eternal. He has no starter in. He's eternal God. Number two, not only is he eternal in the blanks you're writing there, he is unchanging. Jesus Christ is the same yesterday, today, and forever, which means God is not like we are because, let me tell you something, we humans can change like that, right? You can be having the best day, man. You're doing great. You're trucking down the road. It's beautiful. And you have a blowout, and all of a sudden, man, you are so mad. We can go from the heights to the depths just like that, right? Okay? You can be having a good day, and then you get an unexpected bill in the mail that you don't have money for, and, man, you're sunk and depressed. Because we change. We're human. We're finite. The cool thing about Jesus is he's eternal Alpha and Omega. He's unchanging Alpha and Omega. And he's going to love you the same way today that he loves you tomorrow and forever. And then look at the next one. Jesus is creator. Everything he made, including you, because he is the Alpha and Omega. He knows you. He made you. He loves you. All of that is contained in this idea that he is indeed the Alpha and Omega for our life. That is incredible. Okay? So, Jesus is the Alpha and Omega for my eternity. You can depend on him. You can trust him. Here's the second one. It gets even better. Jesus is the Alpha and Omega for my salvation. I want you to get this. We are in what is called the Easter season. Next Sunday is Palm Sunday. 2 weeks from today is Easter. And we're thinking about what Jesus did when he came and he died on the cross and he was buried and he rose again. We're thinking about the fact that he was beaten and scourged and flogged for our sins. We're thinking about all those things at this time of year. Jesus is the Alpha and Omega for my salvation. Now, we're going to connect some dots, right? Are you with me? We're going to connect some dots. We're going to connect Revelation 1, Revelation 22, and Revelation 23, and we're going to connect a dot with Galatians chapter 4. We're going to just connect a dot. What do we do when we connect a dot? We see the big picture. Look what it says. When the right time arrived, the Alpha, Jesus, or God sent his son Jesus into this world to be born of a woman. Let me tell you something. Jesus is the Alpha Omega for all of my eternity, but he is also the Alpha and Omega for my salvation. And that salvation had a beginning. The beginning point of salvation for Jesus coming to this earth was the birth, the Bethlehem, the Christmas event. That was the Alpha, okay? Keep reading. We're going to connect another dot. We're back in John chapter 1. The Word became flesh and blood and moved into the neighborhood. I love how the Message puts that. The Word became flesh and blood. What is that a picture of? That is a picture of Jesus being born as a human being. That is a picture of Jesus coming to this earth, being born as a baby. Okay? The Word became flesh. That's the Alpha. That's the beginning point. John pointed him out. John the Baptist, not John that wrote the gospel. John the Baptist pointed him out and called, "This is the one. This is the one I told you was coming. He's coming after me, but in fact, he was ahead of me. He's always been ahead of me. He's always had the first Alpha word." Okay? Another dot connected. Jesus Christ is the Alpha and Omega of my salvation. And there was the starting point there in Bethlehem. Keep reading. Now, we're going to see it. Long ago, we're connecting a dot. Hebrews chapter 1. God spoke to our fathers by the prophets, but in these last days, these Omega days, He has spoken to us by his Son, whom he appointed the heir of all things, through whom he also created the world. We've already talked about that this morning. He is the radiance of the glory of God and the exact imprint of his nature, and he upholds the universe by the word of his power. And after making purification for sins, omega, because what happened? What started in the manger ended on the cross. What started in Bethlehem ended up on the mountain of Calvary. And so after he made purification for sins, the omega event, he sat down at the right hand of the majesty on high. Guys, you've got to see these beginning and ending alpha and omega bookends to understand. He is the alpha and omega for all of eternity. He is the alpha and omega for my salvation. Keep reading. Look at the next one. Looking unto Jesus, the author, alpha. What does an author do before a book is published? He has to have a starting point, right? Okay, before you ever read any of your favorite novels, there's some guy sitting around with a computer in a room or a tablet or something writing this stuff down. There's the author, the alpha, and what does it say? The finisher of our faith, the omega, who for the joy that was set before him endured what? The cross, despising the shame, and is set down at the right hand of the throne of God. You've got to connect the dots. When Jesus says in Revelation 1, 22 and 23, I'm the Alpha and Omega, you've got to connect a dot here to Hebrews chapter 12. Because Jesus says, I'm the author, the Alpha of your faith, and I'm the finisher, the Omega of your faith. Isn't that incredible? Connecting more dots. Look at this one. John 17, important passage. And John 19, we put them together. I finished. What did Jesus say? Alpha and Omega, beginning and the end. What's the synonym for finished? You end something when you finish it, right? I finished Omega, the work you gave me to do. I brought you glory on the earth. Now, if you know anything about the crucifixion story, you know that Jesus was nailed to the cross, and you know that he made seven statements while he was on the cross, the seven sayings of Christ. Do you know that the last of the seven sayings of Christ is in John 19, 30, and it was simply in English, three words. It is what? Finished. In Greek, it's only one word, tetelestai. Okay? I did go to seminary. It's hard to believe. Okay, tetelestai. It is finished. And what that means is Jesus said, I am the Alpha and Omega of your salvation. And I now, on the cross, as I die, I am finishing, ending, omega, your salvation. And then he bowed his head and died. And in fact, if you really want to get an even bigger perspective, let's connect another dot to the book of Hebrews. One more dot we're going to connect. It says in Hebrews chapter 4, a very important verse, his works have been what? Finished. Omega, since the foundation of the world. The salvation that God provided you was no afterthought. The salvation that God was provided you was not some kind of spur-of-the-moment, knee-jerk reaction to sin. God had long ago planned out the fact that Jesus was going to be your Alpha and Omega for your salvation, and he was going to come as a baby in Bethlehem, and he was going to end up as a Savior on the cross. Our salvation began in the manger and ended on the cross. Write that in your notes. Our salvation had its alpha in the manger and its omega on the cross. That is why Jesus came. And when it was finished, then 3 days later, God put his stamp of approval on what Jesus did and said, yes, son, you did it, and now you're alive again forever. Man, that'll get you excited this morning. Jesus is the Alpha and Omega for my eternity. He is the Alpha and Omega for my salvation. But we're not done yet. Because, guys, it gets even better. Because look at this third statement. Well, let me just give you a little bit of a... I wanted to put this in here before I go to the next one. Look at this. Martin Luther. Anybody remember Martin Luther? He is the reformer who changed the course of history. He became the founder of the Lutheran Church. And look what he says. I love this. We believe that the very beginning, what is that? What's the Greek word? Alpha. And the very end, what's that word? Omega of our salvation. And the sum of Christianity consists of faith in Christ, who by his blood alone, and not by any works of ours, has put away sin and destroyed the power of death. Now that's cool. Alpha and Omega. Are you with me how important those statements are? Can you see how incredibly powerful those words Jesus said? You know, because what do we do when we read the Bible? Now, can we be really honest today? I do it all. We read the Bible and we gloss over words like that. Dang, Alpha and Omega, big deal, so what? Who cares? Right? Alpha and Omega, big deal, so what? Who cares? I mean, we've read it 1,000 times. Did you ever read those words and really think about the impact of what they mean for you? I love that. We believe that the very beginning and ending of salvation, and in fact, the whole sum of Christianity is what it's all about. The Alpha and Omega, Jesus Christ. Now, let's go to the last part. Jesus is the Alpha and Omega for my eternity, for my salvation, but guess what? For my life right now on April 2nd, 2017. He's the Alpha and Omega for your life. He's the beginning and ending for your life. Now, what am I talking about? I'm talking about that as the Alpha and Omega, he has a beginning and he has an ending for you. I want you to get this. Really important. As the Alpha and Omega, he's got a beginning and he's got an ending for you. Now, we're gonna connect some dots. Remember, Revelation 1, Revelation 22, Revelation 23, Jesus said three times, I'm the Alpha and Omega. Now let's connect a dot all the way to the Old Testament book of Zechariah. Okay? When's the last time you ever hung out in Zechariah? Okay? It's not one of those books that's really, really prominent. It's not one of those books people usually turn to for inspiration, but it's a great book, great truth, and look what it says. Do not despise this small, what? Beginning. Have we heard that word before today? Do not despise this small alpha, for the eyes of the Lord rejoice to see the work begin. That's talking about your life. Do you know that God rejoices over you to see his work beginning in you? Have you ever thought about that? That God himself rejoices and celebrates you and what he wants to do in your life. That's what it says. He rejoices over seeing the work begin that he wants to do in you. And it may be a small beginning. It may be a small beginning. Because one thing that I've learned, guys, sometimes we don't understand in the very beginning all that God's going to do in the end. So let's connect another dot. Let's go to Job chapter 8, okay, the book of Job. In the Old Testament, a much bigger book, okay, it's not the book in the Bible about work and employment. It's not called Job, okay? Hey, the Bible talks a lot about work. There's a whole book in the Bible called Job. No, it's not Job, it's Job. It was named after a guy. And look what it says. God is talking. Even if you're what? Beginning, what is that? Alpha was small. Your end, your Omega, will be very great. Now think about that. God starts something in your life, it may start as a seed. You know, every giant sequoia redwood in Northern California, that is one of the most breathtaking things. If you've never done that, you've got to go and see those incredibly humongous sequoia redwoods, the largest tree in the world that some have grown for centuries and centuries. And they all started from a small seed. Even if your beginning is very small, your end will be very great. What a dot that we want to connect. Now let's connect another one because, guys, it just gets even better and better. Man, it gets better and better. Let's go to this next one from Isaiah chapter 46. We're going to connect a dot. Are you ready? God says, think about this. Students, I want you to get it. I want you to get it. Adults, I want you to get it. Think about this. Wrap your minds around it. Take it to heart. Now, when God says three times that you better be listening, you better be listening. When God says, think about it, wrap your minds around it, and take it to heart, man, this is important stuff. You don't want to miss it. He says, remember your history, your long and rich history. In other words, remember the Alpha, the beginnings. Remember where you came from. Then he says, I am God, the only God you've ever had, the only God you ever will have. I'm incomparable. I'm irreplaceable. Keep reading. From the very what? Beginning, Alpha, telling you what the ending, Omega, will be. All along, letting you in on what is going to happen and assuring you, I'm in this for the long haul. Assuring you, I'll do exactly what I set out to do. I said it, and I'll certainly do it. I planned it, and it's as good as done. That's what God says about his purpose in your life. Man, you ought to get excited about that. I have a God who has something so great for me. It may be a small beginning, but it's going to be a great ending. And God is saying, I'm with you for the long haul. I'm going to do it. I've said it. I will certainly do it. I planned it. It's as good as done. See, God agreed with me. All right, I love it. Yeah, you can't plan that. Thank you, Lord. That's all you can say. All right, yeah. So when God says it and God seals it with thunder, man, you better listen to it, right? Okay. This is incredible. Because there are some of you that think that God's work in my life is never going to happen. There's some of you that think that I have messed up my life so bad, God could never do anything through me. There's some of you that think that there is no way that God could take somebody ordinary like me and do something great through me. Let me tell you something. You're listening to the wrong person. You're listening to the devil, and you're not listening to God. Because God says, I'm telling you, I am going to do it in your life. Man, that's exciting. I want you to read something on screen. It's in the box in your notes. Really, really important principle. Jesus gives you the beginning, Alpha, you need, so that he will take you to the ending, the Omega he has planned for you. Now, let me give you some really, really deep insight. I want everybody really look up here, eyeball to eyeball with me on this one. No matter what your life has been, no matter what twists and turns you've had, no matter what hurts, no matter what pain, no matter what sin and mistakes, no matter what failures, you know what we have a God that does? God takes all of that stuff and he puts it just metaphorically like he's making a big cake, and he puts it in this big bowl and he mixes it all together. Your hurts, your pain, your sins, your struggles, your issues, your parents, your background, your ethnicity, your race, your gender. He puts all that there and he mixes it up and he has an incredible end for your life. And everything that you've gone through is preparing you for that incredible end. You think, well, I really messed up my life big time. Do you know what? God's going to take that mess and make a message out of it. You don't even know the test that I've been through. God's going to take all those tests and he's going to put them in that bowl. He's going to make you have a testimony. You see, this is what God does. God takes all of the junk in the beginning, the Alpha we need, so that he can give you the Omega he has planned for you. And in fact, let's connect a dot to Jeremiah, because Jeremiah 1:5 says, God speaking, before I shaped you in the womb, I knew all about you. Do you know that before you were ever born, God knew everything about your life? Everything. He said, before you saw the light of day, I had, say it with me, holy plans for you. The beginning you need to take you to the ending he has planned. Now let me tell you something. I don't know why I was born into a family of incredibly dysfunctional people. I don't know why my parents were knocked down alcoholics every day of their adult life. I don't know why I grew up in a home of violence where my dad regularly beat up my mother. I don't know why I was sexually abused as a child. from the time I was 5 all the way until I was 13 by my older brother. I don't know why all of the things in my life happened. But I know now, looking back on the whole thing, every one of those events, tragic and difficult, God has used in that alpha to create. Do you know David was the youngest son of a man named Jesse? And David was insignificant and overlooked in his childhood. Do you know that historically, if a man had a large farm, a large concern, a large ranch where he did shepherding, do you know that it was tradition that none of his sons were ever shepherds? It was a tradition that if you were rich enough and wealthy enough, which Jesse apparently was, that you had hired hands to be the shepherds. You didn't have your son there. Why? Because shepherding was dangerous work. Do you know what shepherding is? I'm going to give you a definition. Shepherding is days and days and days and days and hours and hours and hours and minutes of the most incredible boredom and monotony. You're sitting out there and you're sitting out there and you're sitting around a bunch of sheep and it is so boring. And the other side of it is a boring, monotonous life punctuated by very few but incredibly difficult moments of danger when a thief, a lion, or a bear comes to get the sheep. And so David out there, he shouldn't have been out there. He was the son of the father. One of the hired hands should have been out there because it was a dangerous profession. But David's out there, and you know, he's out there as a boy, and he's out there, and you know what boys do? Boys don't want to just sit on their butt all day. They want to do something. So somehow God gave him an idea. He got an idea. Hey, I want to learn how to use a sling. And so, you know, you're sitting out there day after day. What do you got? You got nothing to do. You don't have a tablet. You don't have an iPad. You don't have a phone. They don't even have a cell signal out where he was anyway. And so what do you do? Well, he had a sling. And he did for hours and hours and hours and hours and hours and hours. What did he do? He practiced with that sling. Do you know that slingers in the Bible, that's what they were called. Slingers, you look it up. Google the word slinger, not swingers, please. Google the word slingers in the Bible. And you're going to see that slingers were very important. They were part of the army. There were guys that were trained. And in fact, it says in the book of Judges, get this, that a slinger with great skill could hit within a hair's breadth of his target. What is a human hair? He could get that close. And you know that slingers who really knew their skill could have the same momentum when their rock left their sling as a .45 caliber gun? You Google it, it's true. The speed of that stone. So what did David do all day? He had nothing to do. He was bored. So he started slinging. He started slinging. And he started slinging. And he's a little kid. And he started slinging. And he gets better. He's a little kid. And he starts slinging. And he gets better. He's a little kid. And so all he does, man, you do something long enough, you're going to be good at it. Okay? I mean, you do something long enough, you're going to get good at it. So he got good at it. And then there's his alpha. Get it? There's his alpha. His dad said one day, hey, Runt, your big brothers are fighting a battle. I want you to take them some provisions and supplies. So David the Runt leaves the sheep. Now, how do we know that David didn't have to be a shepherd? Because God, the father sent him on another job, and he had other guys that could step in and be the shepherd. So David didn't have to be the shepherd. He was just the runt of the family, and his father didn't really care about him. So he was out there. You say, well, why are you being so mean to Jesse, Pastor Chuck? Well, the Bible says the guy didn't even care about him because when they came to anoint the new king of Israel, he didn't even remember he had a younger son. Then finally he said, oh, yeah, I got a younger one. He's out there somewhere. So David went to where his brothers were. Now, this is all part of the Alpha and Omega. Don't miss it. And he comes upon his brothers, and they are fighting the Philistines, and they're intimidated by this giant. This guy that could be anywhere from 8 to 10 feet tall, this giant, probably weighed 400 to 600 pounds, this giant. And this giant Goliath every day would go out and he would stand in his gleaming honor, his gleaming armor in the sun, I'll say it. And he stood like this in the sun and he had his chest out and he stood there and he defied God. And he defied the armies of Israel. And he cursed and he mocked and he laughed and he joked and everybody wouldn't hid. And he said, come and fight me, you weak, puny people. They wouldn't fight him. In fact, it says that Saul took his tent and moved it to the back of the camp. Finally, David comes, and David said, what's going on with this guy? Everybody said, it's the giant Goliath. And David said, what are you guys hiding out from? And he asked around, and he found out that whoever would kill the giant would be free from taxes their whole life and get the king's daughter. And David said, that sounded like a good deal. Listen, sometimes you need some motivation, right? Of course, you wanted to honor God, but maybe the free taxes and the free daughter was part of the deal. So anyway, David goes and says to Saul, I will fight the Philistine giant. Now, Saul tried to dissuade him. Saul tried to talk him out of it. Saul did everything. He said, you are not the one to do this. I mean, you're just a kid. He's a giant. He's a mercenary. He's a trained warrior. You're just a kid. You're a shepherd. You're a teenager. Teenagers, listen to this. You're a teenager. And guess what? David said, he connected some dots in his head. It all kind of crystallized. He said, you know, when I was a shepherd, I killed a bear. You know, when I was a shepherd, guess what? I killed a lion with my sling. And he said, I'm going to kill this Philistine. Now, why do you think in that alpha, that wilderness, that shepherding experience, that small beginning that David had out there in the field every day for months and years learning how to do a sling, do you think God had a great omega for him? The omega was that God was going to use this little kid to kill a giant. You talk about a beginning and an ending. Is that incredible? Do you think David ever had any inkling when he was out there with the sheep that one day he was going to kill a giant? Okay, he didn't know that was going to happen. He had no idea it was going to happen, but God did. God already planned it. And so God had this shepherd who has become a giant killer. Now, one more. Fisherman to fisher of men. I love this. Peter was a fisherman. You know why Peter was a fisherman? His dad was a fisherman. You know how his dad was a fisherman? His dad was a fisherman. That's how it went in those days. It wasn't like you had a lot of career options, okay? Your dad's a fisherman. He's got the fishing boats. Guess what? You're going to be a fisherman. And so from the moment Peter was a child, he grew up around fish, and he grew up around boats, and he grew up around nets, and he knew what it was to cast the net out of the boat and to bring in a big whole net full of fish. And he had this imprinted in his head about casting and fishing and reaching out and bringing in all of these fish. And one day, that was his alpha, and one day Jesus said, I've got a different omega for you, Peter, because you've been a fisherman. Now I want you to be a fisher of men. You see, you had your alpha. You thought you were going to be stuck in your whole life casting out nets on a boat and cleaning fish and being around fish, and it was a smelly business and it was a monotonous thing and it was day in, day out drudgery. Peter, I've got a different end for you. You're going to be a fisher of men. Don't despise the small beginning, because God has a great end in store for you. And all of Peter's boldness and brashness, because fishermen were notorious for being bigger than life characters, and they were strong and they were courageous. You can't go out in the middle of the storm, and you can't go out and do what he did, pulling in that hoo thing. You know, Peter had these bulging biceps, okay? Right, Elvin? The bulging biceps, right? Our new drummer has arms about the size of tree trunks, in case you didn't know that. But I mean, these bulging biceps, man, he's pulling in these nets full of fish, and he's this bigger than life, strong guy, and he had courage. And why do you think Jesus not only called him to be a fisherman, but to start the church? Because he needed a man of courage and conviction, which is what Peter was. In fact, Peter was had so much conviction about who Jesus was. When Jesus was about to be betrayed, he pulled out a sword and he went after him full bore. Do you remember that story in the Garden of Gethsemane? And he's flailing the sword. He wasn't a good aim, but he's flailing the sword and he cut off some guy's ear. Okay? That's Peter. Fisherman to fishermen. He had a small alpha beginning, but God had an incredible omega ending. Now, here's my question. This whole sermon's leading up to this question. What about you? What's your fill-in? Because I left that intentionally blank, because I want you to fill in your story. What is your alpha? What is God showing you about your omega? Where do you think God has taken you? What do you think God wants to do with you? Some of you, as I said earlier, you've written yourself off because you don't think God could ever use you. Some of you don't think that God could ever do anything through somebody like you. Some of you say, well, God can never use somebody with my past. Just read the Bible. It's all full of people with worse past than you have. You see, don't despise the small beginning. Don't despise the small insignificant alpha, because God is going to bring a great omega from your life. But there's one thing you've got to know. Everybody I mentioned, Moses, David, Peter, had a commitment to God, which is why it happened. You see, you've got an insignificant small alpha. You want a great omega. You first have to have a commitment to God that is unswavering. That's what they had. You see, some of the reason why you are stuck in your life where you are is because you are not committed to God and you don't have any desire to follow God, and so you're not having the omega that he planned for your life. Let's connect a couple of more dots, then we're going to pray. Going to connect a dot to Philippians chapter 1. I'm going to give it to you in two different versions, but this is really the heart of the Alpha and Omega. Look what it says. God is the one. Circle that. God is the one. You don't start the work and you don't finish the work. That's the problem you're having. You're trying to do it on your own. God is the one who began, what's that, Alpha, this work in you, this plan, and I am certain that he won't stop before it is what? Complete, what's that, Omega, on the day that Jesus Christ returns. Have you connected the dot in your life? God says, listen, I have started a work in you and I want to complete it. I've started a small alpha beginning, but I've got a great omega for your life. Let's look at it. In the International Children's Bible, which really sometimes puts a good spin on these verses, God began, what is that? Alpha. Doing a good work in you. And he will continue it until it is what? Say it. Finished. Omega. Thank you, Gary. When Jesus Christ comes again. Look how he ends it. I'm sure of it. I'm sure of it. You might not be sure of it. God's sure of it if you commit your life to him. And so when Jesus made this incredibly bold statement in Revelation 1 and Revelation 22 and Revelation 23, and he says, I am the Alpha and Omega, the beginning of the end, he said, for all of eternity and for your salvation, but even more than that, for your life today. Wow, that's powerful. Don't despise the small beginnings. Don't think because you had a rotten start that you're going to have a rotten finish. God changes the story. What did God do for Moses and David and Peter? God changed the whole storyline. That's what he does. Because their history, listen, are you ready? This is the good one. This is worth tweeting. No. Their history became his story. Their history became his story. That's what he wants for you. Let's pray. Father, thank you so much that you are indeed a God that is the Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the end. And you have such an incredible plan and purpose for our life. And God, as we connect the dots in our life, we begin to see your hand in ways that we never saw before. Lord, as we begin to connect the dots and we begin to see all of the ways that you have worked, even in spite of our pain and problems in our past, God, thank you that you have worked to create this incredibly new, powerful Omega in our life, this new end. And so, Father, we're grateful that we have a God who loves us that much. We are grateful that we have a God who takes us just as we are, and he works in our lives. Lord, you did it for Moses. Lord, you did it for David. Lord, you did it for Peter, and you're going to do it for us. If we're committed to you, devoted to you, love you with all our hearts, we pray in Christ's name.